Uy, está chévere.
And what's also very iconic is the very, very last scene of the movie, which of course don't talk about now, but that's amazing. The last 10 seconds are fantastic. Really cool. Yeah. Really great.
I think it gets even more scary when it has like the children playing sound to it.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Phantasm. And interesting, if you know the movie, if you know the time the movie came out, and of course the soundtrack is of the same year, I can imagine, that those movie is still cult until today, and even the soundtrack is for sure on the more expensive side of things. That's, I think, is quite mentionable when you consider how it was at the time and how the movie was regarded, right? Stanti, you know the movie probably?
Yeah. Don Cascarelli, who did I think three, maybe four of them. I think the movie is called a large part due to the soundtrack, because the movie is fun, but it's not a great movie, let's be honest.
It's like one great movie.
But it's not, it's fun. It's a fun movie from the time, but it's a low budget, the story makes no sense. But the soundtrack is pretty great, which is, that's, I think, a large part of why people love that movie, because it's not a great movie, so you have to find more. And the soundtrack is, I would hazard that it was probably not a big release back then, which
absolutely. And maybe we will see this tonight quite often. Would you say that in this case the soundtrack is better than the movie?
Oh, in this case I would definitely say so. Yeah, and as you can hear, like the synthesizer melody loops like that, of course it reminds us also of Halloween, of John Carpenter.
Absolutely, John Carpenter, absolutely. Here we go with Halloween. And maybe give us a little more impressions of Phantasm before we get to another one, but because this is really... Thomas, what do you know first, the movie or the soundtrack?
I think I knew the movie first, because I was, me too, yeah. When it came out, I didn't know about soundtracks for those, or where to find them. Mm. I don't think you ever saw those in Denmark, those soundtracks.
That's true. Nadine? Soundtracks, guten Abend, by the way. the soundtracks, again, and topic with not a specific genre. So, meaning that you are probably a fan of blaxploitation movies, I can imagine, Superfly and stuff like that. Is that correct?
Absolutely down my alley. Chef, super famous blaxploitation soundtrack. I think Isaac Hayes was the first African American who won an Oscar for best soundtrack song. So I love the blaxploitation movies. They are a great variety in the 70s. Some of them are skyrocketing expensive, but fortunately some of them you can still find for a decent price. But getting especially some rarer soundtracks like the Meg in decent quality is really getting difficult.
That's true. But when you listen to this, let's say, Halloween-inspired soundtracks, what's your take on those? What you just heard? Is it okay, but not more? Or would you say, hey, why? That's not so
I
bad.
Love the Halloween soundtrack. I love everything what John Carpenter did because I love the movies so much. So for me, this goes absolutely hand in hand. So I remember the first time I've seen Halloween. So, and this is for me a complete experience, the soundtrack together with the movie.
Halloween, the first soundtrack is of course cult, but for like people who like diggers, the one that really matters is Halloween 3. Because of course, like these soundtracks are not just John Carpenter, it's John Carpenter with Alan Hofworth. And the third one is the one where there's like a beat, like a really something that you you could DJ that, but just because of the beat in it and the groove, it's more it's not just music for the screen, because like most soundtracks are music for the screen. There are people whose whole music collection is movie soundtracks. I tend to find it a little weird because, let's be honest, most soundtracks don't work that well outside of the movie context, at least in my opinion. Like, especially, you know, like fake classical music or classical music used for like Hollywood movies, like they are meant to elevate a scene, but by themselves, they are pretty interchangeable and anonymous.
Oh, Santi, sorry, I tend to disagree a little bit in one regard. Of course, you are not wrong, but where I disagree is that when I listen to a lot of those electronic ambient music of today, it has become really cineastic in general. You know what I mean? When you listen to them, although they are not, they could be the movie score.
I mean,
in many cases, in my opinion.
Yeah, but then you can say that of about any sort of music, I would say. I don't disagree with that, but I think it's valid for everything. It's just that it's a trope that started with this kind of music. Like, for example, if you listen to a soundtrack that is very famous, the Conan Barbarian soundtrack, it's Basile Poulouderos. Like, it was massively popular. But it is like kind of classical music with a lot of drums and meant to be heroic and all that. Like, why would you listen to that outside of the context of the pictures of these, you know, these heroes with the muscles and all that, and the violence and all that? Like, outside of the context, it kind of makes less sense, in my opinion. What do you think, guys?
Thomas, you think you can enjoy those titles without all of the context of the movie? I think so. A lot.
I have it a little bit like Christmas. It's certain times of the year that is fun. And I have put together a set for Halloween that I would love to play at some point that I think is amazing. It's all different kind of things, but it's not something I listen to like every week. And especially not like this, but in soundtrack in general, like Black Exploitation, I think they have some hits you can play all year round. But soundtracks normally is something I listen to it a lot because I work in the film industry. So we always listen to a lot of soundtracks to get an idea of what fits to this scene, how far can we take it, could we put more electronic into it, and who did that, and it worked. So I listen to a lot of soundtracks, but it's not something I sit and listen to at home.
Okay.
Thomas, you're wearing a nice T-shirt. I've just seen it.
Yeah, it's Batman. Original Bias Club Batman. Batman.
I love that shirt.
It's the first Batman logo from 1939.
Oh, wow.
I love it. Nice. You too.
Nice shirt.
Yeah. We talked about it today. That's
Little commercial.
You will open up a merch shop, I see.
Yeah, exactly what Manfred wrote. Of course, we also have to distinguish between the score and what they do. Again, a question, do they do it more nowadays with all those stars who does a song? Or that, when did it start, with James Bond, or was that always the case? Did Ella Fitzgerald or Louis Armstrong or Marilyn Monroe, did they do songs for movies? I think they did, right?
I have a fun story about that, actually, about like when did things start and all that. Now I'm not in studio. I wish I could pull these records off, but I think it was in 2002. I was at the Miami Winter Music Conference, and there was like a press conference by Jeff Mills, the techno artist, who has been commissioned to do many times soundtracks, new soundtracks to old silent movies, like movies as often. And someone asked him a question, and it was, did you listen to the original soundtrack before you composed your own version? And it struck to me, there is no original soundtrack, because back then there was a guy on the piano playing the music on it. And back then also, you have to realize that the job of the guy who was actually the operator of the pellicula in the theater, well, the movies were traveling from city to city. So his job was, before he played it, he had to check the whole film and take out all the stills that were damaged. Because that's what happened, which means that a movie that started in New York and ended like in New Orleans 9 months later was probably like 5 minutes shorter. Because they had like throughout all this showing, which means that you couldn't have a soundtrack that was timed exactly to fit the movie, which meant that you had to have someone to live play the music. So there's all these things that are quite, in my opinion, quite fun to consider how all these things changed throughout time. That when you started to have someone who recorded a score that was instrumental, and then you had songs sometimes, then you had songs that were commissioned, or was it, what was first? Was it like a song that was commissioned specifically for a movie? I believe it was probably that. And then we have also like movies who use like, it's basically a compilation of songs. And you have also movies who have a compilation of songs and a score, both at the same time.
Gerard Port, music please. Thomas, can we fulfill Gerard's wish?
Too much talking.
Sorry. Sorry, Gerard.
I don't think that was not in a bad way. Yeah.
I think I continue a little bit in the horror movie, and I'll show those albums that I think is collectible for in that area.
The night he came home. Popol Vuh, of course. Yeah. Wow, this record is amazing.
Thank you.
But that's not so typical what we connect with Halloween, right? So more on the classical side of things.
Yeah. I think collecting those to find those in good condition could be difficult, and even though they're not that expensive, but in good condition, they're difficult to find. And I think, like the soundtrack here, there's a lot of reissues that that are quite nice and really good quality as well. So, and I think if you have this one is original.
Yeah, this is interesting because it's, if I remember correctly, it's the first time that Ennio Morricone used electronics in a soundtrack, because he would never do that, but on that one he did.
Yeah. Wait a second, the thing is Ennio Morricone?
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I had that wrongly connected in my head, okay. Oh, here we go. Cool.
And if you buy it as a reissue, you can often get like a box like this.
And what's interesting also...
Yeah, that's wonderful. Yeah, it's amazing.
But when Tarantino did The Hateful Eight, mm-hmm. He hired Morricone, and he wanted Morricone to do basically again the soundtrack of The Thing.
Okay. For it.
And I don't remember exactly how it turned out, but like they had to compromise something.
But why didn't you just take the soundtrack of The Thing then?
Because
this is a wonderful edition, right? You know when this came out, Thomas?
5-6 years ago.
Yeah, okay. 2016 or 18, something like that. It's very collectible, but it's not the original.
I go for the original, but I think it's called Waxwork, the label. Yeah. I think what they did, they opened my mind to find out what kind of original soundtrack I need to look for, because they put out, I think, 130 of those horror soundtracks, and I maybe never heard of them.
Yeah. So Tarantino used the outtakes, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I knew there was something like that, yeah.
Okay. So, that was the, more or less Hollywood horror movies, if I'm not mistaken. Okay, Phantasm is not.
What? Yeah, it kind of is.
Yeah, it kind of is, fine.
It's just those movies, they're always really nicely made.
Yeah, Rosemary's Baby. Those are from this reissue label, nice.
I tried to collect
them. I think like the people who are like horror movie fans, they are collectors. You know, they want to buy stuff, like mm-hmm. if you produce something. So I think the one of the aspects of the resurgence of the vinyl record market is also partly due to that, like a lot of companies suddenly like selling merch to horror movie lovers in the form of vinyl movie soundtracks.
So you mean that when it comes to those kind of horror movie soundtracks, a lot of non-vinyl collectors buys them because they buy everything connected to the movie?
100%,
That might be possible. That's also why they do those elaborate packagings quite often, right?
Exactly, because it has to be
an object. Exactly. Nadine, favorite movie scores of yours? Name to Shaft and the Black Exploitation already. Are there favorites in other genres? What is it with Ennio Morricone in your case? Oh, that looks in
control.
I don't know that. Are they kissing? Yeah.
Totally out of control.
And there are two versions of it. I think one came out later on in Spain and it has a different cover, but this is the original one. And it's really getting difficult to find this one. And it's like a very cheesy kind of music. But I absolutely love that one.
Are we here in the regions of what was it? Ice castles? Oh, listen.
Tiny little bit.
Tiny little bit.
Tiny little bit. But otherwise, I have some Morricone reissues up there. But this is my so far my favorite one from him. Nice. In Control. Mm.
Stunt, your take on this record? Do you have a take on this
record? So Morricone, he is, yeah, I think by far the most prolific soundtrack composer. There are a lot of soundtracks of his that were released while the movie was released. There's a lot that were released on CD in the 80s, and there is an ongoing flow of unreleased soundtracks from back then that are being released in the past like 15, 20 years now, which is great. And I'll show you just quickly like three examples. One that is very, that was very popular because of a song, like we were talking about songs. This one has a collaboration between Morricone and Joan Baez. There's a song that became very popular outside of the movie, even if it was composed for the movie. But the soundtrack, the score by Morricone on it is really deep, like the kind of like Italian library, spy jazz, dramatic, very, very cool. Then there are movies like this one. Also, not something that was very popular or anything. This is like more modern classical Morricone.
Okay.
It's really good. It's not like wow, but when you listen to it, and yeah, it's good. I want it. And then like some great stuff, like yeah, this one was never issued back then. L'Istruttoria è chiusa dimentici. So this is, yeah, this was issued in 2004 on Dagord. Dagord is a great soundtrack label that issues mostly stuff that was never issued on vinyl back then. So they've been around for like 20 years at least, as you can see. But they are exclusively a soundtrack label. And yeah, this is great. I would hazard that there's probably, like Morricone, he was doing like 9, sometimes between 9 and 15 soundtracks a year. Like in the I mean, he's so known for all the Dario Argento early stuff before they went
before Goblin,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Amazing soundtrack. Thomas, have you prepared something for us?
Yeah, I just looked up where it comes from. We change a little bit. We go to Hong Kong.
Oh, I get an idea what we go into now. But now it's getting wonderful. Really, really wonderful.
It's one of those albums that I listen to as a soundtrack.
This is Wong Kar Wai, but not in The Mood for Love, as I said wrongly. Oh. It's another movie also.
But who's the composer on that, Thomas?
Shigeru Higashi.
Thanks for the question, Santi.
I was having a little bit of fun, but like Wong Kar Wai always worked with this guy. And you know, like when we hear the stabs first, like instantly I see the scene of the movie. So
we can. Let's talk a little bit more without talking, because this really is beautiful in my opinion.
But you can definitely hear the Morricone influence in this, because the very, yeah, the minimalist dubbing there, it's like a conceptual thing that didn't exist before Morricone in movie soundtracks. Mm-hmm. On the etching, is it an etching or a picture disc, Thomas?
No, it's an etching.
Here we go. And this is everything, cover art, the label, beautiful job.
Je sais que c'est direct réglé, mais
Thomas is now switching the record. Nadine, have you seen Wong Kar-wai movies? You know this?
No, I haven't. I have seen the trailers. They are very monumental movies and
wonderful. I think In the Mood for Love is something you really should watch.
I might check that out. I love the movie.
In the Mood for Love was a very big change for him, because before that he was doing like thriller action movies or Shambhara movies.
Hong Kong movie style, right?
Yeah. Exactly.
But better.
Yeah, well, he was doing artsy, like higher, like his biggest movie back then was the Ashes of Time, which was a Shambhara movie, and then he did like also like a Hitman movie. I don't remember the name now, and he did even a sequel to that.
And Ashes of Time was this with in three parts, right? With the queen.
No. It's just like a one, unless I'm wrong, but it's a movie from the 90s.
And of course, never like a good tradition from them, never a happy ending. So be prepared. Take your handkerchiefs, Nadine. Be prepared. Trust me on this one. So,
if I should make a movie, it will be like one of his movies, because what I'm good at in the movie industry is like making a style and look into the movie. And I think he's been a great inspiration for the things I want to do.
Yeah, and I think who also got inspired from him with his movie was Tom Ford.
Yeah. They only did 10 soundtracks like this. It's Hong Kong releases from a label called Locked to Music.
Is this the only chance to get them on vinyl, or are there other versions? I think it's the only one.
Some of them have other versions.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, but I'm not sure. I don't think that this one has has another release. I think it might be the only one for In the Mood for Love.
Yeah.
I think that's the only way to get it.
Is it still easy to get, or is it getting difficult to get?
I can see like the one 2046 is from 320 euro, so they're getting quite difficult to get.
Wow. Hey, Joe. Wonderful. Yeah, they did wonderful editions of those. Damn, I should have bought them when they came out.
Look, and they come with a poster as well, like a big poster of this one. And the booklet, that is really nice as well. So they're really collectible. I really like
them. So those are your personal copies, that we won't see records of those in the, at the OVC shop, right? Those are keepers.
I bought them one by one from Hong Kong. Mm.
Okay. Okay. Stan, do you have those kind of records too?
No. For me, this is the kind of music that, like, I've seen the movies, and when I listen to the music, I see the scene instantly. So I'd rather watch the movie. It's like what we were talking earlier. For me, I don't feel most of that music stands on its ground enough for me without the movie. But it's good, and it was very good idea to do that for the movie.
Yeah.
And they did 10 releases. They're really beautiful, all of them.
Those are beautiful, and the way you show them together with the music, like an artful. Missing the champagne.
It's a nice package. Yeah. The jackets, the music, that really fits beautifully together.
The only thing that's missing is champagne.
But I think when it comes to the work on the cover, I've never seen anything more beautiful than this.
Okay.
The way the picture is, the look of it, the quality. No, not even the big list. Now, this is the best I've ever seen.
Okay.
They're really, really nice.
They look fantastic.
I have something quite similar, but also quite different, that is probably my favorite soundtrack. Then.
Go. What is it?
Michael Brook.
Tell Michael us Brook.
What's interesting is, like, Michael, you might recognize the design here, because this came out on 4 AD. So there's the Vaughan Oliver, but you also have like this, it's for a soundtrack. So it's the one movie directed, by, what's his name again? The guy who got canceled in Hollywood. But it's a great little movie. Michael Brook invented the infinite guitar for Brian Eno, and he did a bunch of really good, like, avant pop records, guitar, bass, ambient in the 80s. He did also most of the soundtracks for the Canadian director Good Hereafter, Thomas, help me, The Adjuster. Anyways, this movie, what's interesting is it's a mixture of like, it's tracks, songs, some have some dialogue from the movie. The musicians on it are like amazing. There are tracks with like Flea on the bass from the Red Hot Chili Peppers. It sounds nothing like the Red Hot Chili Peppers. It just sounds like a very, Atome Goyan. He did a lot of soundtracks for Atome Goyan. And I remember really liking the movie for what it was, but thinking that the movie was really elevated by the soundtrack, and the tracks stand out. You can listen to them individually. It's kind of like, Penguin Cafe Orchestra, Tuxedo Moon, Brian Eno, but it's also its own thing. And it was released for some reason on 4AD. Well, because Michael Brook was signed on 4AD. And I believe now it's not an easy record to find.
But, interesting. Yeah. Never saw this. And this is your personal favorite soundtrack?
It's one of the top five, yeah. It's really one I put often on.
So when it comes to your style of music, when you go into, let's say, the Nurse of Wound direction, do we have soundtracks who cover this kind of music?
Kind of like you could, like, or like influence of that, and like, I mean, if we're talking about the conceptual aspect of things, for example, there is let me see if I can find it here. I would say that something like that, like classic 60s UK.
This looks like a Finders Keepers soundtrack record. Wonderful. Kind of.
Yeah, wonderful. It's the cover art is amazing.
Amazing.
What's interesting on it is that there are two songs by Basil Kirshen on it. And he did quite a few like Hammer movie soundtracks that have like kind of pastoral, very cheerful, jazzy feeling, and then something kind of off in it, like a little bit disturbing. And I guess a good Nurse with Wound movie, not necessarily the soundtrack, but would be something like this. Performance,
okay.
Yeah, where you have Mick Jagger playing two roles. And the soundtrack is not extremely experimental. It's Jack Nietzsche, who did a lot of great stuff in Hollywood. But there is something a little bit off there. A soundtrack that is completely unpredictable when you see who is the composer, and a movie that most people have probably forgotten, with this one.
Lipstick.
Because the composer is Michel Polnareff, the French pop singer.
Okay.
But the B-side of it is a complete electronic avant-garde experimental music piece, because it's a movie, so he...
That's a strange combination. That's a strange combination, huh? Yeah,
It's absolutely... Well. It's fantastic. The track on it that is great is... Basically, it's two soundtracks to two different movies, like Lipstick on one side, and the other one is called The Rapist. But it's really good, and it's a record you can find in dollar beans because people don't know what it is. Yeah.
The jacket alone isn't worth a dollar. The record, the jacket alone.
Brilliant. It doesn't look like anything. Yeah.
Exactly.
But I could go on, but like, let's...
Let's go to Thomas. Maybe he has prepared something for us again.
I changed to another style. I have a few here. I think it's worth collecting as well.
Mm-hmm.
called Silver Screen, and they only made 7 releases as well. But I think the fail, when you see the Hong Kong one, everything is the highest quality. Those are nice gatefold, but not half as nice as the other one you saw.
But probably the same price.
Yeah, the same price.
That's a bad combination.
And if you can see the record player, let's try to make it in a gold edition as well.
I showed this. Oh, dangerous color. Dangerous color.
Yeah.
But you seem to have been lucky.
This one is black. So the second issue in black.
Oh, okay.
But they made some of the famous American soundtracks that you I don't think you could get it all the way, like
Guy
and the Chocolate Factory. This is a really nice release here. I don't think it was out in any other versions.
Mm-hmm.
But it picks like a Rambo.
Rambo. That looks like a horror or action.
No, yeah. It's
The Third Man. Okay, very famous soundtrack, at least in Germany. Beautiful. Okay, I don't know this one. Ah, very old. Nice.
So I think they did some of the soundtracks that never was out before.
Mm-hmm.
They're really nice, but not the same quality. I think then they stopped suddenly. They made those 8 releases and then...
They stopped
doing it.
But the music is wonderful again. But it's also in the direction of the Wong Kar Wai movies, right?
Yeah, it is, yeah. Very much. I think that was an inspiration when Tom Ford did.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Give us some more seconds of it.
Oh, we get something else now.
Of course.
I think we go to Italy.
Always a good time. And now we have to be back.
I love it, but some of those, there's another one featuring, what was the actor named?
Charles Bronson,
Cita Violenta. This is also a great soundtrack from, I think, Ennio Morricone, and it's really hard to get.
Yeah.
He did something. Oh.
Yeah, it's one of his best ones, in my opinion.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. It's got reissued many, many times.
Stunty move. Thank you.
Always love with those Italian soundtracks. They're really, really high quality as well. Really well recorded, well produced.
How is the market on the originals, Thomas, when it comes to those kind of records? Probably more and more difficult to get, but still out there.
Everything rare from Italy is too expensive.
The one he's holding in his hand is a 1,500 euro record. If you find it. Okay.
I have an idea. I buy the movie rights. Maybe they are cheaper and it comes with the record.
No, it doesn't come with the record.
No, it doesn't come with the record.
They're smarter than that.
Wow.
Yeah, this song is on my want list for decades now. For decades. You can't. It's difficult to find that one.
But Thomas has it, Nadine. Look.
I bought it in Den Bosch.
Okay.
Yeah. In Den Bosch, there was an Italian seller. He had a lot of those really good soundtracks.
Nice.
And I think it's 4 or 5 years ago, I paid maybe 300 euro for it.
That was cheap.
Yeah, that was the price at that time. He was not cheap with anything. That was just the price to.
Yeah,
but then everybody wants them.
Yeah.
By the way, now that you say buy them, the OBC right now is full of amazing soundtracks. By the way, so if you're interested in these kind of things in this genre, have a look at the OBC shop. There are really quite some editions now for sale on every price range. They start at 20 euros and goes up until higher prices. Give us a little bit more. I really dig this music right now. You have something similar?
And especially maybe. If you're into black exploitation movies, there are some nice soundtracks as well on the OBC side.
Yeah. Mm. Oh, yeah. Oh yeah, this is a rare one too. Yeah. And in an amazing condition. Wow.
I have a track that I love on it. I'll just play it.
What label is that on, Thomas?
That's on A&M, CAM, like
yes. So it's a library label, library soundtrack. That was also because it's so close. Italian library soundtracks and Italian soundtracks. It was often the same label.
That's true, Santi. Also, musically, it's sometimes quite.
Yeah, I didn't know that last time we talked about library music. So I'm actually a big fan of the Italian library music because they're really, really nice.
Because if you look at the cover that Thomas is holding, and if you look at a library from the same time,
quite similar. Yeah, I think you showed that, right?
Yeah,
you
probably. Yeah,
very similar. Right?
Is that the same label?
No, this is on. On Cermi, Edizione Cermi, it's Bruno Nicolai. I forgot.
I'll play a little bit on the track Strip for a Teenager. I love this track.
I love the title.
Sounds promising.
Sounds very promising. Thank you. Do you all agree with me when I say that was the most jazziest soundtrack so far?
Yes, but it was a very specific type of jazz also. So it was like movie soundtrack jazz, like noir movie, cool. And yeah, that one is a winner for me.
It is, but do you also agree when I say it was a little, that Twin Peaks seems to be a little bit inspired, Angelo Badalamenti?
Sure. Absolutely, Michael. That it's totally Twin Peaks on some scenes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
When the daughter of the hotel owner, I forgot his name, when she danced alone.
But this is from before Twin Peaks. So Twin Peaks is.
Thank you for reminding me.
No, but it's it's interesting in music, in a movie soundtrack music, you often found pastiche of other, like it's way more common to see that. Oh well, yeah.
Yeah, the Perversion one is I think 1969, Twin Peaks I think 1991. So yeah.
So but we won't see 8 copies of these at the OBC, I can imagine, because this again is one of those really really rare ones, right?
I think so. I think I bought it from the same guy. I can see. I don't know what it is now, but I can see I paid $450.
Yeah, it's 20. Around $400 on Discogs now. Yeah,
and this is a near mint copy.
Hmm.
So I might got him down to $350 or something.
Nice, very nice one.
Thomas, will you be in Den Bosch this year?
I will be there every day this year.
Perfect. One round we need to go together.
Yeah. I missed the last 3 ones, and the last one here, I got a new hip 10 days before, and I was hoping to get there, but
yeah, he didn't make it within 10 days. Can you imagine how weak after surgery? No, kidding aside. Thomas will be there. A lot of us will be there. We will probably have our own OBC booth over there. So if you are at Den Bosch, come to us, sit with us, talk with us, have fun with us. It's not about selling records over there. We won't have the typical booth with spins. We won't. We just want to have a meeting point, a point where we can discuss things, where we can talk about things. And finally, in some cases, that we meet in person and have just some fun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I might bring a box of rare records.
Yeah.
The record that Thomas was playing, this kind of music, yeah, you find it in Italy and you find it also a lot in England. This one was never released back then. It's a Kenny Graham soundtrack, and it was issued first by Trunk Records. This is exactly noir, spy jazz, really cool stuff. What's interesting with soundtracks also is that because of its nature, a lot of soundtracks are released when the movie is released, and a lot of them are first released sometimes 30, 40 years later. Mm-hmm. So sometimes you have to be on the look for the, for example, a movie that has an amazing soundtrack, that I'll show you quickly. Where is it? There it is. This was also released on Trunk the first time. The Conversation, Francis Ford Coppola, David Shire, who did the music, who was the husband of Talia Shire, Coppola's sister. It was issued on vinyl when the movie was released, but only the theme on a 7-inch in Japan. So sometimes that's what you have also. You don't have, there's a lot of movies in the 60s, 70s that have a release, but not a full release. And of course, you have like outtakes now that like people who are obsessed will find as well. But like this kind of looks cheap in a way, but it's the first time it was reissued, so.
No, not reissued. That was my question, because I made at the very beginning of my channel, was in the very early times, I put this up on a video of mine. And this is an original then.
Yeah, it becomes an original, even if it looks like a reissue. It is.
It's an original.
Yeah, even if the theme of it does exist on a 7-inch in Japan.
Yeah, but that's different. But that's a different thing, right? So if they put that out 30 years later, the issue of 30 years later is an original.
Yeah.
Period.
I totally agree.
So this conversation. Yeah. Come again.
And it's a fantastic movie. It's
a fantastic movie and a fantastic soundtrack. Thomas has put up some records. What? Oh, okay. They go back.
I have one more Italian that I'll play for you.
Great. Careful now, although I like it. That was a little bit Dead Can Dance.
Yeah, but I think with early the Italian dance soundtrack, they always sound, they always have their own personality.
Yes, and I have another question. I have another question, if you allow me, for Stanti, because he opened up a very interesting topic which I hadn't had in my mind, Stanti. You talked, when it comes to the Italian movie soundtrack, you talked about the library records, which makes total sense. How often does it happen that they actually took songs from a live record for a soundtrack and it became famous? Dawn of the Dead?
Dawn of the Dead was made, the soundtrack of it, there's two versions. There's the American version and the international version with the Goblin soundtrack. The original version uses only library soundtrack cues from different movies. So this was someone at the label had to find out which library soundtracks have been used, find them from this record, mm-hmm. and compile mm-hmm. them into the complete original soundtrack of Dawn of the Dead.
Soundtrack,
because it's not a score. It's like, it's literally short tracks of library soundtracks used mm-hmm. there, and they're like glued on the movie. I think there's last year there was a new edition of that came out, a double LP or triple, that is even more complete, but I'm not totally sure. But for the longest time, that was the only way to get that soundtrack.
Interesting. Thanks for sharing this.
But I'm curious, like Sounds of Poet had a question that maybe is naive in a way. Let me put it on.
Sorry, like,
no, but it's at the same time, it's an interesting question, because if we just go by ourselves, could there be a consensus anyways? In my mind, there kind of is one. There is kind of one soundtrack that everyone loves and that really transcends the movie. The movie is great, but the soundtrack is even greater.
Great, brother.
No,
you only can Dirty talk about Blade Runner. Suspiria, Dirty
Dancing.
I think Suspiria is really the greatest soundtrack of all time in terms of like the project. Like, okay, we're gonna do the music for that movie, and what it becomes, and what it becomes outside of the spectrum of the movie itself. It's so good and so unanimously celebrated and loved that it's kind of too much for me. I loved it, but I wouldn't put it in my favorite soundtracks just because I've heard it so many times and it's everywhere in a way. But what do you think, Thomas? How high do you
rate it? before we get into it, I have a question. I want to ask the gallery something. Please, all of you, if you want to, put up your favorite soundtrack of all time. Maybe Thomas has them and we can get something out of it, or we can play some of them. And maybe Clued, yeah. And maybe Thomas also has Suspiria, the Goblin soundtrack. Then we also can get into this one. Write your favorite soundtracks if you like. Share them. Yeah, Clued, of course. Sutherland.
Oh, I love that movie. And the soundtrack,
Yeah. Godfather. The movie has aged not as good as the soundtrack, in my opinion. This is like, it's not even a question. For me, this is by far my favorite soundtracks of all time. It's Michael Smalls. This was never officially released. The rumor is that this was actually a bootleg made by Michael Smalls himself, who bribed the guy who... the guard of the archives that had the soundtrack, so that he could record it and do a bootleg release of it. I don't know how true the story is, but there's never been an official release of that on a real major label. And this is kind of like right in between like creepy Italian soundtracks, like very eerie, like jazzy stuff, pop 70s, like soundtrack pop music. It's Nadine knows it, obviously. So
I love it. And even in 1977, there was an unofficial release of that soundtrack with a very iconic cover. So, but I'm trying to get your version. And I never thought that there is really a soundtrack, because I was looking for an original version. I couldn't find it.
But if it's a bootleg, it's difficult, probably. Huh?
Yeah, when there's will, there's a way.
Yeah, that's true, and you've proven that for quite some time now. Thomas, back to you, back to Copenhagen.
Welcome to Copenhagen.
But shall we see also Nadine's favorite soundtrack ever?
Ooh. What is
You know, this is rare when you hear some crackling, because if Thomas shows us the copy with some crackling, it means like he's looked for other copies and he didn't find them.
Is that true? I have a near mint copy of this one as well, but it's up for sale.
You didn't like that, right? That was nothing.
Yeah, I hate that I'm not a millionaire. And
was that so expensive again? Again, such an expensive one?
I think that's the one which is now in the OVC shop.
Okay.
Yeah. Let me have
Yeah.
And this is an excellent near mid copy.
Yep.
The one I keep, it comes with another cover as well. This is the same record. That's why I played a little bit lower quality, because I just stopped. I like the originality of this.
Yeah. That's wonderful. And I didn't expect when you started this song, it totally shifted. When you hear the first minute, you don't think that it comes or goes this way, this funky.
It suddenly turned into be a copy of Shaft in that area. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But a good, Come again, Nadine.
It has some electronics vibes in the beginning.
And I'm the DJ. Even wrote, is it 33 on 45? that wasn't a winner. Wow.
But as always, when it's a good one, it's also difficult to get it because everybody wants it.
Yeah.
That kind of brings your thought that is, I think, quite obvious. Even if we like the movies, like the Wong Kar-wai soundtracks and all that, like they're pretty and they're neat, but genre movies tend to have more interesting soundtrack.
Come again, please. Because I didn't.
Genre movies. Mm-hmm. Tend to have more interesting soundtracks, like the blaxploitation, horror mm-hmm. movies, horror. Sexual thrillers, paranoid thrillers, because they can maybe, there's more room to create a world of itself, rather than, like, you know, with a big epic drama, you will have classical music-like music, which is not as original. It can be great, it can be beautiful, but like, all the soundtracks that people are obsessed with most of the time, I mean, it's not a absolute, but tend to be, genre fiction movies.
Interesting point. Interesting point, yeah.
Can I make a wish from the wall?
Probably. Everybody can make a wish from the wall. Everybody.
So my wish would be Blackula.
Blackula, okay. And by the way, just for your interest, if you're interested, Thomas, at one point he will be back to the huge wall when it gets warmer in Scandinavia, and he doesn't freeze to death when he sits there. Thomas will probably be back at the large wall, right, Thomas? Or wrong?
Yeah.
Correct me if I'm wrong.
But this, I think this one is, that's also what you do with those black. It's 21 minutes long, this track.
Wow. Yeah, but I have no problem with 20-minute long songs. Quite the opposite. Usually I love long songs. I love it.
Yeah. I think you know, that it is
you don't love it when you want to pull out a 45 RPM version of it. Then you don't love it. But otherwise, it's great.
Yeah. Yeah, and you can change it a little bit during the time. Start electronic and get into this. This never get boring. It's always fun to listen. If you hear it really loud on big speakers, it sounds amazing as well. I really like it.
Is that also a song that you would play as a DJ when you are DJing? Is that something you could and would play, Thomas?
Yeah, part of it. I might play the intro and
Yeah, 20 minutes might be a little bit.
Of course.
Well, if you need to go to the bathroom, it's a good one.
Yeah, exactly.
Then you could play Love to Love You Baby, 16 or 18 minutes version. Time to sit on the train and go to the bathroom.
I did that a lot of times.
I see.
Right. Just something else.
Just to address someone asked us if we could show some soundtracks that are not expensive and super rare. We already did it. Like, if you look back,
we did. We didn't show only our expensive stuff. And when you go to the OBC shop, there are a lot of records, 25, 30, 35 euros. No. The majority of.
You should absolutely check out the OBC shop right now.
A lot of.
A lot of them are already gone.
Right. A lot of them are gone, but.
This one I'm playing after this one now is a cheap one, and it's one of my favorite Black Exploitation. So it's not about the price, but there's a lot of good stuff.
Yeah.
1 minute.
This one you can be lucky to find for little nothing, but else it's like a 20 euro record, and it's amazing the whole way through. But it's Mayfield that made the songs and used it.
Perfect the combination.
Yeah.
And the stable sings are one of my favorite soul gospel. Amazing.
Reminds me, Michael, the very first record fair you went to, where I assisted you a little bit. Remember once record you bought there that is a movie soundtrack, very cheap, and very close to what you do.
Amazing.
Can you go pick it up, maybe?
Oh, no, I can't.
Okay. It's the Irmin Schmidt. Irmin Schmidt from Cannes soundtrack.
That is a fun part. Yeah. Aren't there three parts?
Yeah.
Yeah. Amazing.
And the first two are great, the third one is not that good, in my opinion.
But Santi, it's not a movie, right? It's songs he wrote for movies. It's a compilation in a way.
No, it was used in movies. It was it's a compilation of, because that's the thing.
Not this one, but
one Ken record, let me show it.
Yeah, of course.
Not all soundtracks are, you know, 45 minutes long. A lot of soundtracks are like less than 10 minutes long, because there's like a lot of movies, art movies. Like my favorite soundtrack composer besides Morricone is Toru Takemitsu, and Japanese modern classical composer.
Yeah.
This is a series of 10 LPs of the film music of Takemitsu. So, yeah. And this has soundtrack. Sorry?
They look quite the same. Is it a series?
Yeah, it's just like the background. It's the same illustration with some variation in the background. You can't, like you see here, it's dots. This one is. You see here has this whole. But Piro Takemitsu is like the biggest modern classical composer from Japan. But he did do all the soundtracks in the this is the music spanning from the mid-50s to the late 70s. And he did all the soundtracks for Ozu, Kurosawa, and all that. And often you have like three soundtracks on one LP. Because
okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah,
because
yeah.
That was all the music that they used during the movie.
Yeah.
And those are amazing, very cool to collect. The music is great. You used to be able to find them like for 35, 40 euros, which is quite good for a record like that, I think. Now they're more expensive, but you can still find them when you're lucky for that kind of price. So it's not like super cheap, but it's still, it's a good hunt, a good target to hunt.
But they came out in Japan, right?
Well, you see OB, there's apparently there's a box set of it, but I've never seen it. I bought them over time, seeking all of them.
When did those records come out, Stanti?
In the mid-70s, I think, mid-late 70s.
Because you have them in amazing shape. I thought they are quite wonderful shapes.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
I guess most people who bought them, the music is not bombastic, so it's probably people who are more mellow as well.
And they take better care of their records. So that was
maybe. I don't think it was a big, it's because already the concept, you buy an LP and there's three soundtracks. It's compilations of soundtracks from the same composer.
Mm.
It's not popular music, let's put it that way. But if you've seen the movies of Kurosawa, which I guess most people have seen at least a few of the classic ones from the 50s, he did most of them.
Mm. I think Thomas is preparing once more for us.
Yeah, it was a soundtrack that I didn't know before today. So I just
before today.
I don't know why. And I listened to it, and it's up on the OBC, and it's 20 euro. But the funny thing, I'll play a little bit here.
Munzio. The jacket alone.
Munzio.
It's the same feeling as the expensive soundtrack before. It's just like that. There's a lot of soundtracks that are between 10 and 20 euro that's available, and are quite good.
Yeah. I think this is the whole genre makes sense nowadays, because as you said, it doesn't have such a different feel and touch like the way more expensive ones. That's really surprising and a very, very good thing. Yeah.
And I think if I look, we have more than 1,500 soundtracks on the shelf. So there's so much. So that's why we sometimes have a little bit more expensive ones, because then you know it's a good one, you know what it is.
Yeah.
There's a lot of, if you have time, there's a lot of good soundtracks there.
Wait, I forgot to put up the link for the shop. Now I changed that. Now it should be there. Sorry. Sorry, no, it's there. I forgot that.
Nadine, what track from Black Hula would you like to hear?
There he is again.
Where he is
this
again.
This is the fourth track on side A.
across the street.
He's a self-assured like he was before, and I know he thinks I want him more and more, and I know he thinks I want him more and more.
Now for the real man. Santi doesn't like me, he danced with his eyebrows.
So there's a nice twist to that record, actually.
Give us a
because twist. Do you know who's singing the backing vocals on some of these tracks?
Paul McCartney.
Rock the Boat. One of the first tracks who helped to make disco mainstream is the Hughes Group, and they did the backing vocals on this one.
Nice.
Yeah. And I mean, imagine.
Oh, sorry. Sorry, go.
I was able to talk to the guy who wrote many of the tracks, produced them, and was the one who found them, was Wally Palmer. And I talked to him on the phone. He's like over 90s now, and he told me some nice stories. Rock the Boat is one of the first. Rock the Boat, and what was the other boat or rock song? Rock the Boat, and there was another one. Another boat. Yeah. It was Rock the Boat and another one. And I totally forgot it.
See, Nadine, you're getting, you know, you're coming closer to my brain.
No.
Yes. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Not as worse as this man here, but still, Nadine. That was a cool one, Nadine. Thank you. Yep. Blackula.
And it's easy to. It's really not super expensive. It's like around, I think, 70 euro around that range. But it's a very nice one and done by Gene Page. Gene Page did a lot of stuff with Barry White and also some great solo stuff. So I really dig that soundtrack.
Nice one.
It's an album that 20 years ago, 15 years ago, before you started to go into the internet to look for records, it was one of those really, really rare ones. Nobody had, and somebody found one in America, and it was a huge thing in Denmark.
Yeah.
But when you started to look up on Discogs came and stuff like that, there was actually quite a lot of them. So it's not like a really expensive one, but at one point, everybody thought it was a mega rare record.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is one of the examples. When the internet came up, the people got aware it's not as rare as we all thought. Is that safe to say?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you might be
interesting.
Okay.
It's a record you see every now and then in record stores. It's not. An invisible record by any means. The movie was very popular.
Yes, I loved it. And the second song was Rock Me Baby. Thank you, French Vinyl Addict. It was Rock the Boat and Rock Me Baby.
George McGray, okay.
Yep. Actually, Rock Me Baby was written by KC from KC and the Sunshine Band, and he gave it to George because KC couldn't hit that high notes, and so George.
Okay, I remember that song, and I actually liked Rock Me Baby.
Yep.
And now that I remember, I like it.
Good dance track.
So sorry if I interrupt often, and I don't know how it is at your place. I have, for the last 10 minutes, a terrible connection. I try my best. Germany.
Thomas, do you have...
I think the best connection today...
Yeah, Swedish forest always. Huh? do you have this at hand, Thomas? Because this is the Roy Buzz Get Carter theme is probably one of the absolute best themes of movies ever, in my opinion.
I need to hear again.
I put it on screen there, the Roy Budd's, the Get Carter soundtrack.
Oh yeah, I have that one.
Yeah, you should play that one because. Yeah,
I look for that. I hadn't taken it for it, but that's I think it was my favorite soundtrack 10 years ago, and there still you love
see.
It.
Yeah,
it's like Get Caught is really famous. And really
I have a 10 inch of Ja Wobble doing covers of that theme, and it's just amazing. So you have like the Roy Budd Get Caught for theme, but like dubby at the same time. Post-punk dub.
Okay. Yeah. Wobble did that, okay. Yeah, maybe it's the wind energy by at Sweden, right? Because my Sweden internet
today... It's more, it's the, you know, the water, you know, when they have like, I don't know the word in English, when they have these walls to stop the water to create electricity. That's what we have up in the north. But no, it's the...
In Germany, we call it...
Staudamm.
Thomas is looking for stuff, maybe I can show. I think one of the most important soundtracks, in the sense that it changed a lot of things of how we look at soundtracks, of a movie that was, it's a movie that was very important because it was the first movie of that director. He won the Golden Palm, and I believe that's probably it launched the career of that musician as well. So it's the soundtrack of Sex, Lies, and Videotape. Really, so the first movie by Steven Soderbergh, who's like one of the biggest names in cinema now. And that was his first movie, which won the Golden Palm in Cannes Festival. The guy who did the soundtrack of this is Cliff Martinez, who used to be the last drummer of the Captain Beefheart Magic Band and the first drummer of the Red Hot Chili Peppers. And when he left the Red Hot Chili Peppers, he looked into doing movie soundtracks, and that is his first work, like a first-time director saying, yes, do my soundtrack for me. And it's an ambient soundtrack, not necessarily made by only synthesizer, but it is really, really ambient. Back then, it was really novel. It was something that... You would have, if you think about that soundtrack that you love, Michael, the Blade Runner. Blade Runner is electronic. It is ambient-ish, but it's not ambient. Mm-hmm. This is ambient, like drone music. And it's from 1990 or 1991 or...
I remember the movie, of course. I don't remember the music. And well, the first 1 minute, I didn't hear anything, so I can't not get into it. I'm sorry, because I didn't hear it.
Oh yeah, yeah. Well, thanks. Well, the music is really beautiful. It's a great ambient soundtrack. What's interesting is also that like Steven Soderbergh became a really big movie director, but Cliff Martinez has become a great in-demand movie scorer. He did the Drive soundtrack. He did a lot of movies with a friend of our own Thomas, since he did the soundtrack to movies by Niklas Vidreffen, Danish director. And I think really when he really started to get into everyone's head, it's with this soundtrack, which is one of my top three favorite movie soundtracks ever.
Okay. Also, it's a George Clooney Solaris, right? It's not
Tarkovsky. Steven Soderbergh as well. It's made by him. It's not a remake of the Tarkovsky movie. It's another adaptation of the Stanislas Lem novel. Mm. What's really original about the music on this one is he went to the... he went to the Bachet brothers, who are two French music instrument inventors. They were also spies. They were also like, they had a factory. They were men who had like lives that we should make movies of. But they created one instrument called the crystal piano. The crystal organ, which is like crystal blades that you have to wet. And just by friction, you create these harmonic sounds that sound like nothing else. And he went to them to buy instruments that they created to do the soundtrack for that movie, and it's just completely different than anything. And Jose Moreno
Hunt, really, You really made me want to get the soundtrack. Don't listen to
who. I remember I watched the movie in the theater and I was completely mesmerized by it. I went straight up to the Fnac and bought the CD of it because it was not released on CD, on vinyl back then. And I think I bought it twice on CD because it's a soundtrack I needed in my life.
Look what Thomas got.
Yeah.
So we have a chance to listen to it.
We can.
Oh, that's great. Stanti, have you a recommendation for a title?
I guess it's difficult. I think it's especially like everything is great on this. Like it's a perfect soundtrack, but I think Death Shall Have No Dominion. It's like the fifth track on the first slide, if I remember correctly.
What I'm really impressed with is nobody came up with my favorite soundtrack, and this is actually from the Hacker movie, which was in the mid-90s featuring Angelina Jolie, and there was Prodigy on it and everything.
Okay. Yeah, it was a popular soundtrack for sure.
Yeah, that was wow.
Okay, now we get into the later Solaris movie by Soderbergh.
Meantime, I just finished showing some pictures of some black exploitation albums.
I think this is like Oscar, actually. This is amazing. And you get to the next track to see what we if we get to when he uses these instruments that are so unique.
This is I jumped to number 5 and
uses this.
Is that the one?
It's one of the ones that use it, but like, just like you know it as well. So I just like Michael asked me a question. I'm not good at like which track on it. I just remember visually where it is on the record, but maybe it's on the other side. I don't know.
What? Ah, Superfly, of course.
The cutout cover. Mm. Oh.
Jacket art, the cover artist.
Okay. This one. It's funny, Niels here, he says it's called Border Harp.
Left in Africa. This is funny. Oh, wait, we have a double. We have a triple. We have a winner.
Cleopatra Jones, this is such a great movie. And the soundtrack is great. Cool breeze, yeah. Yeah, Martha Rees sang on that one. I have it signed.
Of course you have.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. That's a great one, too.
Nadine, you have quite some of those.
Of course.
Nice.
Yeah, Three the Hard Way. I have to reissue. Fantastic. Do you have this one, Thomas?
I never seen that.
Yeah, I will text you about it later on. The great story behind.
Can we get all those? Possible that we hear some of those, or one of those at least, from that you just shown?
Coffee. Those,
maybe let Nadine pick. Come on, let Nadine pick.
Which one?
The coffee soundtrack. There was.
This one?
The coffee one, yep. Yeah, this one. You're holding in your hand. Exactly. Yeah. Choose one. Choose one you like.
Amazing. Thomas, you are amazing. To buy all those records, I would really need at least a week.
What does that mean? 40 years.
Then I'm a quick buyer. Mm-hmm. Or fast. I'm kidding, of course. Damn it.
Yeah. Stunt. I know.
110th Street is also, was that Bobby Womack, right? That was also a great soundtrack. Across 110th Street, yep. Bobby Womack. Mm-hmm.
I think the Roy Ayers is one of those that we should dig deeper into at some point. Huge fan of him, and I met him in New York. He was playing there, and I should have been to my friend's birthday party here in Denmark. And he's a huge fan of Reyes. He had a band, Brother Green, that was called after a Reyes song. So I couldn't be to his birthday, but I sent a picture together with Reyes and say happy birthday from Thomas and Roy. And he was like, what? That was amazing. And he's still strong, going out playing his xylophone, and it's really nice. And I think he's 80 something.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But here we have a little coffee. It's a classic soundtrack.
And Stunty looked so happy. Okay, Nadine, come again.
And Stunty looked so happy.
Oh, I love this.
I think people will like it.
Roy Ayers, well, it's funny because now we talk about him like he's a genius and all that. In the 90s and early 2000s, people forgot about him, so they knew him because of rap, because he's the most sampled jazz musician, funk musician ever. And he's also like when people loved, you know, in the like the kind of 90s hip hop, like they sampled him because of the Rhodes sound, because he's like the Rhodes keyboard guy. But yeah, yeah. There's so much of it.
Every time when we listen to a record that is attainable, that you like from the very first second with the first listening, everybody thinks, oh, Stachy will not like this. Sometimes it's really unfair. No, when it comes to Stachy, it doesn't have to be always very, very strange. Trust me. Trust me, it doesn't. But hey, you worked hard on that image, Stachy. You worked hard on it.
We work all very hard on our images.
No, well,
as you know, I have to go soon, and I will then reinforce the stereotype, because there's one type of new movie soundtrack we haven't talked about, which is documentaries, because there are also movies and there are also soundtracks to documentaries, and I wanted to just briefly show. Sorry? What did you say, Michael?
I didn't say anything. Okay. I think that was something technical. Nobody said that.
So this is one of my top five favorite soundtracks, which is the soundtrack to the documentary movie Step Across the Border, which is basically a very strange movie following Fred Frith and friends on tour. So it's not like a documentary of a touring musician. It's more like a hypnagogic journey into cities, into America, through the spectrum of musicians, meeting musicians in hotel rooms, on the train, and stuff like that. It's you can listen to it for songs, because it's not like, it's mostly songs or tunes on it, but it's great. Then there's also old documentaries that get reissued, one that Michael and I have talked about a few times, which is the Jocelyn Pook soundtrack, which is a documentary she did in the early 90s, which Stanley Kubrick saw. She did a soundtrack to that documentary, and he saw that documentary and thought the soundtrack is amazing, and that's why he hired her to do the soundtrack of Eyes Wide Shut. And it only got issued like 2 years ago on vinyl for the first time. On a strange label in the UK. And last year, this was issued, this won I think the great prize in the Venice Festival, which is a documentary about the opioid crisis in the US.
Mm-hmm.
And it's Nan Golden, the photograph, who with someone else, and there's a choir, and they recite music also over a soundtrack by the Soundwalk Collective. Mm-hmm. So you even get like documentaries soundtracks that are now issued, and
So very, very, again, a very interesting part of the soundtrack discussion you make up here. What I've learned today, especially today, is in a way we have movie genres, we have music genres, but somehow music genres and movie genres, they get together. Black exploitation.
Yeah, absolutely. The culture is
a certain. Did you hear me? Have a certain music. Black exploitation, soul, funk, horror. Has a certain kind of music. You know what I mean? So these genres, they get together. Has also documentary, do they have a certain style, a certain music style, and certain music genres? Is it ambient, or what is it?
Sorry, you cut off a little bit, Michael.
My connection is terrible. In a nutshell, movie genres and music genres, somehow they get together sometime. We have very similar music when it comes to horror movies, very similar music when it comes to black sport.
But it also changes a little bit over time, because nowadays most horror movies have very like abstract soundtracks. Like it used to be very orchestral stuff in the late 80s. In the early 80s, it was more synthetic, like minimal, John Carpenter and stuff like that. Yep. Yep. And now we have either like symphonic or almost like musique concrète, like electronic sounds, no melodies, like atonal music. And we haven't even talked about something else, which is, it, maybe there's no reason to make a distinction, but TV shows, TV series, that now you even get like soundtracks of
totally true. But what we also didn't cover is the importance and the influence of the score from Star Wars.
Yeah,
I think it also had a huge impact on soundtracks.
Yeah, but Jerry Goldsmith was like, yeah, he's the most successful soundtrack composer in the sense of movies. Like he composed the music to the biggest movies. Like Ennio Morricone is for me much more important, but
I get the point. Yeah. And today it's Hans Zimmer, right? The German composer Hans Zimmer. Yeah. It's now a Goldsmith.
You know, a funny story about Hans Zimmer. Maybe Thomas knows some stuff about that. I have a friend who is a composer and who does soundtrack work, and he works for Hans Zimmer. So Hans Zimmer has an office in Paris, one in London, one in Moscow, one in Tokyo, and probably one in Los Angeles, one in New York, so that he has people working for him on like 24, all like it never stops. There's always, and everyone has access to the same like cloud so that they can work collectively so that it never stops. Yeah,
around the clock. Yeah, if you consider his output, it totally makes sense.
And one time I was in my friend's studio in Paris, which looked really creepy. It was like it looked like greenish dark room, and I was seeing him like getting the new information in, and it was, I felt almost like I was in a Saw movie, but he was actually composing music for Hans Zimmer. Anyways.
Thomas, have you prepared something for us?
Yeah, I will start it up, and then because we just heard a little bit from another track from Reyes in the background.
This is
a collection of the record from Reyes.
It's a Japanese edition.
Yeah. It's only like this.
Well, this is beautiful.
Yeah, the one I'm playing now, just because we talked about the military TV series. But one thing we haven't talked about, and I think that could be like a whole screen for itself, is
video games.
Video games. It's a huge, this one I really like, but it's a huge industry as well. And those records are, I think they talk to the young people, so they collect those. They're really, really hard to get.
But you know, I think some of it goes along again with the fetishism. People who are into these kind of things, they are so into it that they will collect Funko Pops, mugs, everything around it.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
And you have a lot of picture discs when it comes to music for computer. The most impressive music when it comes to video games for me is the Final Fantasy series. They have an amazing composer who works for them, and the music is wow.
And we also talked about documentary movies, and I just put a little here because I think this album is amazing, fantastic, and it's one of my good friends here in Copenhagen who made it. His name is Jonas, and this documentary came up this year as nominated for an Oscar. So he only made 100 of those vinyls, and I put one up earlier, and it was sold right away.
this one, yeah. Careful, yeah. This is amazing, This is amazing.
And I have a few more copies, so I put a few more up. But cool,
because this is really.
I think he'll do a second batch, but of the first one, which is 100 promo copies.
What kind of music is that?
That's everything from jazz to big orchestra to it has a variety of music. And the film, you should Aphrodisia, you should watch the documentary. It's about a girl who wants to be an artist and a way into to being a big artist. She's a big artist now in Denmark and
okay.
based of the biggest places. But she grew up like in a with a family. They lived a little bit like in a circus. There was a theater in the house, and but it's an amazing. You'll be in tears and you'll laugh and you'll follow. Look at this movie. That's the most important. And I'll put a few more of the soundtracks.
Please remind me of it later, Thomas, if you can.
Yeah, I will.
Sorry, I just my internet connection tonight is terrible. But I know this record we talked about, and this is really quite something special. And congratulations to the one who got this copy. This is amazing. Yeah.
It is amazing. Jonas Struck.
Wow.
The whole video game thing made me think of a soundtrack I have that like is a little bit fun. It's more like the music is okay, it's good, but it's this.
Oh yeah,
Lord of the Rings.
But it's not what you think.
Okay,
it's a double LP, and it's the soundtrack to the Hobbit movie, the animated one from the late 70s.
I remember this one. I saw this.
These are images from it, and it's actually pretty good. And it's something that I don't know, like sometimes you find it and no one cares for it, it's always cheap, but they haven't done too many of it, I think.
Yeah, but it's a picture. How is the quality? I'm afraid
it's all right. it's not problematic.
Okay.
But it's just it's
beautiful.
Yeah, it's a cool object in a way. It came out on Fantasy, Nadine. And so it's almost like a conversation piece in a way, but it's good. Which is like basically me telling you that I also like what I believe sometimes people buy these records out of fetishism, and I'm not sure they even listen to them, but it reminds them of what they love about the movie. For me, it's a little bit like that for this record. I don't feel an urge to listen to it that often, but I kind of like to have it. But it's also a cheap record, so
nice. Thomas, how are you? Still,
I'm good.
Still on the driver's seat.
We just talked about this soundtrack, and he just did a new one here. This is which I think it came out a week or 2 weeks ago.
Okay.
And it's getting good reviews, this one.
Yeah, and it's Ole Christian Madsen is the director. I worked with him on Flame and Citrus, which is a famous Danish movie. And so it's and this one should be amazing as well. It came a week ago, I think it came out. I have some copies of this one as well.
You listen to it, or is it new? Okay.
No, it's new for me, but I'll put it up and
wonderful jacket. Wow. And do you know anything about the movie, Thomas? Is it a documentary? Is it a thriller? Is it what is it? What kind of movie are we talking here?
It's Jussi Adler Olsen. He do action thriller movies.
Action thriller. Okay.
So
but does the title kind of mean the one without border or something?
Yeah, it does.
Yeah. Nice. But almost 2 hours, Thomas.
So I thank you guys. Sorry, I have
thank to cut it short on my end. Problem. No, we are almost at the end. We have this 2 hour border, and we all already reached it. So Santi, you made it through. No problem.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye-bye, Santi. Thank you so much. Thomas, one last song, if it's okay.
Oh, I have a few more.
Okay. Oh, even better. The more, because the merrier.
I would like to play another Danish track. And they sing in Danish, so it might be weird for you, but if you like it, it's amazing.
Okay.
Keder mig, så skifter jeg farve. Og jeg gemmer mig, så jeg bliver helt væk. Når jeg keder mig, så skifter jeg farve. Og jeg gemmer mig, så jeg bliver helt væk. Jeg leger cowboy, og så skyder jeg med blæk.
Er du show director? Some insights of this record. What are we listening? This was amazing.
you get a it's a cartoon movie for kids mostly. Kids loves it, but it has, it's some of the best Danish musicians that play on it, and this the singer is called Peter Belli, which is like a huge name in Danish picture. All kind of music. And it comes together with a really, really big poster.
Is this a newer release, an older release? When did this come out?
It came out as a 7-inch in the 70s. Yeah.
In the 70s, okay.
Yeah, early 70s. And so there was only this track. And then some guys found more music from the soundtrack and some hidden games and made it into an album.
Nice.
And, I think I bought 50 copies of this one. I have two left, so I put one up on
the... Yeah, put one up, so we only have two left, okay.
Yeah, but if I sell it, I have a limited edition, which is quite more expensive, but I have a few copies of that one as well.
Okay.
So we see if... but this one is the second issue with the poster.
Okay.
First issue is a double album.
Okay.
Crazy, and then there's some talking in between.
Yeah, that's okay. That's cool.
But I think every kids in Denmark more than 5 years old, they know this.
Okay, it's like Sesame Street for a lot of people.
Yeah.
In Germany, it's probably Rappelkiste. I cannot translate Rappelkiste though.
Yeah.
Remember Rappelkiste, Nadine?
Nee, ich kenne Rappelkiste nicht.
She doesn't know it.
I don't know. I know Sesamstraße.
Mm-hmm.
I know Alf.
Alf. Alf was a bit boring.
Und Alf war großartig.
No.
A bit boring.
Okay, another armful of records. Thomas.
Now, I think it's just one of those soundtracks we haven't talked about, but... of this kind, I'm showing you there's thousands and thousands of soundtracks from that country.
Okay. India.
India.
Yeah, I thought now comes Bollywood. Oh, that's cool.
Bollywood. Oh, the burning train.
Look at the jacket, Nadine.
I know, the burning train. There are some real classical 70s Bollywood movies with a fantastic soundtrack, horrible acting, but they're classical movies. Sometimes you get the impression they filmed them on 8mm cameras.
Krishna Shans Shalima. Dan Thomas, where did you get those records? Did you do a trip to India to get those?
I did do a trip to India, but I didn't see any records at all. So,
okay.
I think they're all over the world, so there's always somebody bringing them to Denmark or Germany or wherever. You can find them, but the good ones are difficult to find.
Of course.
And some of them are some of the most rare, like 5,000 euro. Not what I have.
No. Really? Again? Again, but maybe also because this is such an important part of it, can you give us an impression of one of those records? Maybe that you play one song so that we get an idea. That doesn't look Indian at all, by the way. Okay, now it does.
This one, I think he do the Doors on this one.
Okay, careful with the Doors. Maybe from from the very first one you've shown with the burning train.
Yeah, I just show you this one.
Dashat.
That's amazing. But it's spooky. Really weird.
Okay. Shan. Okay, we get into the burning train now. You know the record?
I don't know the burning train, but I know some of these 70s Bollywood movies. There was also a great documentary out there about the whole story of this and also the soundtracks, and
same output as Hollywood for decades now. Let's have a look at the label. Okay, that looks Jeremiah. That was a trade. Hey, come on, that's not bad. Right. In a way, it's like a melange of what we've all heard. We have electronic, we have funk, we have soul, we have everything in this one.
Yeah.
Burning train.
Burning train. But I expected something completely different. Nice.
I think we should make an episode about these black spot, these 70s or Indian music.
Yeah,
you wanna conquer the Indian market, Nadine? Okay, let's try that.
No, but Thomas has so many fantastic records, so that would be a shame. And he has so many albums.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, there are not many chances. I mean, ask someone, can you please play me a song from The Burning Train from the Indian first edition soundtrack? And said, No, I cannot.
And Thomas will say, what track do you want to listen to?
Which copy shall I take?
Yeah.
Burning Train. Oh, yeah, this is
it. It was a big surprise, wasn't it? Still Burning Train?
No. In India.
Ah, this one. Okay. Wow.
It's going after. It changes one all minute. The time.
This is brilliant. Where did you find that? Because have you looked for this specifically? Because out of those millions of Indian records, it can't be a coincidence, right?
I've when people have some for sale, it's those that are up for sale. You cannot.
Okay.
You can go to a shop and choose. I don't think there's many. There might be shops that had a Indian collection, but it's the more obvious one. The rare one, they always disappear. So you'll find a dealer who have one or somebody who wants to get rid of a weird.
This is okay. For how much money would you be willing to sell this?
I had it for sale once for this. Hmm.
150.
You don't know what it is? No. I thought I think I had it at Utrecht for this, but I haven't checked the prices now. So,
and how much would be the Burning Train? Burning Train.
I don't know.
Burning Train.
So what I wanted to say, we will also make this at the end of the stream. I can mention because I talked about this to Thomas. From every record you see here, also if it's not at the OBC shop, if you are really interested in it, you can write an email for now to the OBC shop and make an offer, a serious offer, of course, because a lot of the records Thomas shows here are not for sale. But if you have a serious good offer, it might change. Correct,
Thomas? Yeah, I might be able to find a copy for you. Connections so that could be interesting. I just have one fun thing more we haven't talked about, and that's like those movies.
Yeah, Joe Hayashi. Yeah.
Those are amazing as well for collecting.
Are those the originals, Thomas?
Most of them only came like this.
Yeah, but there has been a reissue series from him.
Yeah. But some is reissued, some is some only came like this. I can't remember which one was reissued. Or...
Yeah, of course.
Burning train.
Wonderful jacket. You know this guy, Nadine?
No.
He's a, he's a legend.
The burning train.
But this guy is a legend. He is huge in Japan and amazing. Yeah, this one is fantastic. Fantastic records. Yeah.
He has a new movie in the cinema this week in Copenhagen, and it's his movies are amazing too.
Amazing. Yeah. Wow. Again, you're probably complete. This is unbelievable. Yeah, this one. Yeah. Yeah. It's unbelievable. Damn it.
So guys, I'm sorry, I gotta go. I have to pick up the kids.
Okay.
I have to,
they are leaving us. They are leaving us one by one, Thomas.
I just want to show this.
This is, comes out on Record Store Day as a reissue. Then I'm getting it as a reissue. I love that one, Thomas.
Yeah.
Is it a movie score? I don't, what
no, it's a Parliament from 1971.
It's a funk band that the first album they made is more like a rock album, psychedelic rock. And it's not what they expect, but it's amazing.
Yes. Never seen an original, but...
Yeah, no, you did, Nadine. No, you did.
I have virtually seen an original, and I get the... on Victus, and I'm getting the Record Store Day reissue, I hope.
Yeah, it's worth for going for. But wait until Nadine has got one.
All right, everybody. Thank you so much. Thank you, Thomas. It was a
pleasure. Thank you, Nadine. Thank you for taking me.
I enjoyed it tremendously. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye. Bye, bye in the gallery.
Nadine. See you later.
Okay. I saw somebody ask for the T-shirt.
Yeah. Tell us about the T-shirts, what we plan.
Yeah, I'm not totally sure what we planned, but for now, I think it's fun to do a little T-shirt for those Wednesdays.
Exactly.
And today, I did this one with a little bit soundtrack on, and we did another one as well. This one.
Interstellar, exactly. OBC, that's so beautiful. OBC. Well made. So we will have an OBC T-shirt every week. And we haven't decided yet how to do it, what we do it, but maybe.
Maybe how much are we allowed to do?
We will figure something out. Yeah, right. Yeah. Exactly.
But there'll be more. There'll be a new one next week.
Exactly. Yeah, but we haven't decided yet 100% what we do, what we will do next week. But we will do something next week, and it will be again something special that we do next week. Or have we decided it?
I have not decided which one what we go for, but
we will go with some. So what are we listening now?
Another soundtrack. We're back with a soundtrack.
Yeah.
And I think if you hear this,
not possible for now, Justin.
Sweet Emmanuel, your big yellow eyes dig in my mind.
Is it sorry? Black Emmanuel, or what is it?
Yeah, it's
Quick Look. Wonderful. The jacket, and the cover art is fantastic.
It comes with a different covers. I think I have 3 or 4 different ones.
Okay. And does it have to do with the country from where it's from, or why all those different jackets?
No, this one is from Italy, I think. I think there's 2 different ones from Italy.
I think in this case it's a very interesting question, Emmanuel, Black Emmanuel. If you want to have this Italian copy, how much is this? I have no idea. Is it very cheap? Is it very expensive? I have no idea. Do you know it?
I think you can get them from 20 to 400 euro.
Okay.
I think this one is maybe 150, 200. Okay. I haven't looked it up.
Okay.
It's a good soundtrack. You can see I have a lot of
favorites. When you mark them, right, then you play them.
Yeah.
The Manimal were an important part of my preteen years. Of course they were. Of course they were. Yeah, Denmark was quite strong when it comes to this kind of soft porn music. It was a whole industry in Scandinavia, right, at the time. They did a lot of those. And yeah, probably also a lot of movie scores there.
There is, yeah. And the soundtracks are amazing, a lot of them.
Mm-hmm.
They were not cheaply made at that time. They made them like it was normally a movie, but with the, mm-hmm. the porno thing inside. And there's a lot of good porno soundtracks out there. I think I put one up on the OBC.
Yeah, but it's gone. That was gone within 5 minutes, by the way.
Yeah. It's a newer one. It's a totally cool album, that one. It's okay. I think it's from 2011 or something.
Okay.
He'll be happy, the guy who get that one.
Or a woman, you never know.
Yeah, yeah. So should I find a final track for tonight?
Yeah, please give us a final track. We cannot do what we usually do, where we play and record from the topic of next week. So we have a final record of today's topic. And Thomas for sure will find something special.
Maybe.
Maybe we are lucky.
I got an idea what I wanted to play, but it's in my DJ bag somewhere. It's not here.
Okay. that takes too long. Too long. Yeah. But no problem. We have time.
I'll put something up here.
Let's see. Do we get an idea? No, not yet. Okay, last song of the evening.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I love this soundtrack as well. And I might put it up. I think I have an extra copy, and it's not an expensive record.
That's always good. It might become one. Peter Sellers, The Party, of course, amazing movie. Cool. Okay, give us a sample of it. This is more Indian than the Indian soundtrack. Thank you.
You see the same thing here.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the feeling. Thank you, Alex. Nice. Music lovers, vinyl lovers, thank you so much. I hope you enjoyed our movies video. I'm sorry, I had huge trouble today with my internet connection. I hope you didn't feel that too much. And I hope to see you on next week's OBC Thomas Busk Wall of Records. Thank you so much, Thomas, for doing all of this again. And we do it next week. Thank you all so much. Bye.